So we've all heard about the importance of XML first. So I'm going to speak today about JATS, the new NISO standard DTD. First of all, how many people in the room are currently using some flavor of NLM or an NLM-based DTD as part of their workflow? So quite a few. It's not going to be a hard sales pitch here. First of all, what is JATS? JATS stands for Journal Article Tag Suite. It's a continuation of the NLM DTDs. The reason for the name change is that decision was made to put the DTD, the tag set, under the NISO umbrella. So now the working group is working within the NISO framework, and it's no longer controlled by NLM. JATS version 0.4 was released in draft form in March of 2011 for public comment. And then over the summer, JATS 1.0 came out, the final version. It's now an official standard. Just a brief history of NLM. It was initially developed for the National Library of Medicine to support PubMed Central. But as the number of hands that went up in the room show, it's really taken off, especially in the STM community. First version was released in 2008, NLM3 came out, which was a non-backward compatible version. A book DTD was also released at that time. And JATS is just NLM 3.1. It's completely backwards compatible with 3.0. Again, the name change is just to reflect that it's become part of NISO. There are three JATS tag sets, usually referred to as the green, the blue, and the red. The archiving and interchange tag set, which is the most permissive. All of the elements available in JATS are available in that DTD. It's typically used for archiving and preservation, and for any context where you want to capture all of the intellectual property in the article, including those evil punctuation marks and references sometimes. Journal publishing tends to be the one you see most widely used in a production environment. It's the export format generally used for people who are going out from Word into NLM. And then article authoring is geared to what Kaveh was talking about this morning, an export format that you might use behind something like a WordPress author submission tool, where you want the DTD to be very tight and very simple so you can efficiently get the manuscripts into your typesetting system. So adoption, as I said before, NLM's been pretty widely adopted by scholarly publishers. And there are a few reasons for that. The first was that it was built on the best features from the journal DTDs that were available at the time that the DTD was produced. It's also had a lot of community input and support. The people in the working group are very knowledgeable in the community, have really shepherded its growth. And finally, it's modular. It was built with the idea in mind that you could take it and build on top of it. And so a lot of people are maybe using a proprietary DTD in-house, but they're using a modified form of NLM. Just speak briefly about Adipon's history with NLM. We adopted it from the very beginning. We have a member of the staff that's on the working committee, and a lot of the modifications we made to the 2.0 DTD we used got brought into the 3.0 DTD. And the standards are really built into our platform. We require it as a submission standard, as a submission format. We use archiving and interchange for a variety of reasons. And there are other parts of our platform that into which the standard is incorporated. For instance, access control based on article type. We use the canonical list of article types that are in the JATS standard. So what are the advantages of publishers to using JATS? The first is interoperability. If you're using a standard, it makes it easier to get your content from point A to point B. That might be from your peer review system into production at acceptance. It might be between peer review systems. And it might be your hosting provider. Adipon and our competitors are all using some version of the NLM DTDs now, and I'm sure we'll all be moving to JATS. The second reason is tool availability. dare I mention the word processor, but you know, if you all of us have a lot of authors that are authoring their manuscripts in Word, and that's not going to go away completely anytime soon. You know, if you are maintaining your own DTD, you want a tool that's going to export out of Word, you're going to have to deal with that yourself. Whereas you can get, you know, third-party plugins to do that job, and the work is done for you. And finally, there's community support for best practices. The JATS tag library is a marvelous resource, you know, for answering questions about best practices for how to mark up certain constructs. I get asked questions by the publishers I work with all the time about, you know, what's the best way to do this? And it's like, you know, we use the loosest DTDs. There's like 20 ways to do this, but I can point to the tag library and say, you know, this is the best way to handle this. And the bottom line is it's all going to result in lower costs for you, in lower production costs. So what's new in JATS? I want to highlight two things that are in JATS 1.0 that would be useful to people. And there's probably a number of people in this room more knowledgeable about JATS than I am. So during the Q&A, if I've missed anything that you think is important, please you know, speak up and mention it. The first is expanded multilingual support. And JATS does this in a few ways. First is the XML lang element or attribute is now available on almost every element in the DTD. Second, you can use repetition of structures that might not normally be repeated. For instance, a copyright line, if you want to have it in multiple languages, or a set of keywords. The third is the introduction of alternatives wrappers for certain constructs that can only be repeated once. For instance, author names inside contrib tags. You can wrap that in a wrapper, have it in multiple languages. And finally, there's some support for dealing with languages that might be in more than one script, which I'll come back to in a minute. So I just have a simple example here of the name alternatives wrapper. There's citation alternatives wrappers as well, with the author name in both encoded in both Japanese and English. And a couple of screenshots from a demo we've put together with our partner in Japan, Atlas. Here's the Japanese version of the article. And there's the English one. And I learned during this presentation what ankyloglossia means, which is a condition that makes you tongue-tied. The second part, the last part of the multilingual support is support for different scripts. So, for instance, in Chinese, you might have, you know, something might be in Mandarin, but it might be in a particular character set, and there can even be regional differences. So, the recommendation in JATS for handling that is to use a three-part structure, where you specify the language, specify what script it's in, and specify what region. The example we just looked at was just in Japanese, but you know, here are a couple more examples where the script that the characters are in is also specified. And the second big thing in JATS 1.0 is the Condrib ID element is support for tagging ORCID identifiers or you know, whatever your author identifier of choice is, which I think is something that's going to become, you know, particularly important for all publishers over the next 24 months. So finally, what's next for JATS? Add upon something we've been looking at is support for continuing medical education exams, because we have a number of clients that are publishing those, particularly important in medical publishing, and there isn't support in the JATS DTD for that right now. So we are extending the DTD for, you know, our client, for the tag set for our clients that need that. Issue markup is another thing that we've always required. It's not part of the JATS standard. You know, you can go either way on that. I mean, I think the argument against having issue-level XML is that it's an artifact of print and it's going to go away, especially in the STM world, pretty soon. Also, JITS isn't really as, you know, nice an acronym as JATS, I don't think. And the last thing I want to mention is standard book support, which brings us to BITS. the book Interchange Tag Suite, which is now in draft form as of October 2012. What's new in bits? It's a complete rework of the NLM book 3.0 DTD, so it won't be backwards compatible with NLM, with the NCBI 3.0 DTD. Has improved TOC and index support. They've taken the index and TOC, built in the TOC and index support from DocBook, basically. And there's also revised front, back, and body, book body wrappers that are extended and improved. Most of the innards at the chapter level are pretty much the same as they were before and are pretty much JATS-like. It's not NISO at this time. They're continuing to work outside of the NISO framework, but I would imagine that eventually BITS will join JATS as a NISO standard. And finally, I wanted to mention that ISO is now publishing their standards in a JATS-based DTD. It's been modified a little bit to handle some things that they needed, but it's really very close to JATS. And here's the URL if anyone's interested in looking at the content, back content that they've converted, have up online now. So should you switch to JATS? The short answer is yes. Certainly, if you're already on NLM 3, there's no reason for you not to, because it's as easy as changing the public identifier and joining your doc type. If you need the multilingual support, you're certainly going to. And like I said before, probably everybody's going to need ORCID in the coming months, so that's another compelling reason to switch over. And that is it, short and sweet. Here's the URL to the JATS homepage, where then there's also links to the JATSCon homepage, where you can read all the conference proceedings from the JATS conference from the past 3 years.
Thanks so much, Caitlin.